Hi, today's South Dakota adventure takes us to the gold. We're gonna be panning this creek just like Custer's men did in August 2nd of 1874 when they discovered gold in French Creek near Custer, South Dakota. Creeks like this all over the Black Hills are kind of speckled with little flecks of gold that have to be panned up. The creek we're on, well, see, miners don't talk about that. That's kind of each miner's secret. But when gold got out, they couldn't keep the secret very long. A telegram was sent from Fort Laramie announcing to the world there's gold in the Black Hills of Dakota. So the Black Hills gold rush had finally begun. It's fair to say that the news of gold in the Black Hills didn't come as a big surprise to Indian or non-Indians who had tried to learn very much about the hills. Father Peter DeSmet said the Indians had told him of gold in the Black Hills years earlier, and that they had agreed to punish any of their people who traded gold to the whites or had even told them about it. The Custer Expedition of 1874 was not the first gold discovery there. In 1859, geologist Ferdinand Hayden had discovered gold when he was on a government expedition. The report was not published because of the outbreak of the Civil War. One story of early gold seekers in the hills raises some interesting questions. Well, not far from here in the northern hills, over by Spearfish, a stone cutter named Lewis Thone was looking for building blocks on Lookout Mountain. In 1887, he claims to have found a stone with this inscription on it. Came to these hills in 1833. Seven of us, Delacompte, Ezra Kind, G.W. Wood, T. Brown, R. Kent, William King, Indian Crow. All dead but me, Ezra Kind. Killed by Indians beyond the high hill. Got our gold, June 1834. On the other side of the stone was written, got all the gold we could carry on our pony, all got by the Indians. I have lost my gun and have nothing to eat, and the Indians are hunting me. Some people think maybe the stone was a hoax. After all, Thone was an excellent stone carver and he did like practical jokes. But some historians have found records that indicate the names on the stone printed by Ezra Kind are indeed factual. And if the Thone stone is true, had the men lived, the Black Hills gold rush would have begun some 40 years sooner. Think about how that would have changed South Dakota history.
People in towns in and around Dakota Territory had hoped there was gold in the hills. Charles Collins, who was the editor of the Sioux City Times, had made a number of attempts to sneak into the hills, and the army always managed to keep his group from getting through. Now, with the news from Custer, Collins predicted there would be no holding the gold seekers back. Most of the Black Hills were located inside the Great Sioux Reservation, and the government was bound by the Treaty of 1868 to keep non-Indians out. Most of the press and politicians in Dakota Territory wanted the Black Hills open to gold mining immediately. But in the East, many people believed that the Indians had been cheated by the government before and that their rights should be respected. General Philip Sheridan in Chicago and local commanders at Fort Laramie warned that trespassers would be caught and they might be tried as lawbreakers, which in fact they would be if they went to the Black Hills. The U.S. government said, "Wait until we buy the hills from the Indians, then go." The Army's task was hopeless. There were at least a half dozen places where wagons could sneak into the hills. Although the Army tried for a while, there were too many miners, too many trails, and too few soldiers. It's surprising the Black Hills weren't filled with more miners sooner than they were. A number of mining expeditions had been organized in the fall of 1874, but only one party made it successfully, the Gordon Party. 26 men, one woman, and a six-year-old child zigzagged across South Dakota to get to French Creek, where Custer and his men had discovered gold in August of 1874. They pretended they were heading to Nebraska farmland as homesteaders. See, the Black Hills were still being guarded by the military, as agreed to in the Treaty of 1868. Well, they left Sioux City in October, and they wound up at French Creek in December, taking over 2.5 months to make a journey that we could make today in a car in about a day, or take an airplane and be there in just a few hours. The Gordon Party, still frightened that the Indians would attack, built the Gordon Stockade. They prospected for gold as time and winter weather would allow. For several months, neither the Indians nor the Army found them. On April 4, 1875, their luck ran out. An Army patrol found them, and they were forced to leave the stockade and go to Fort Laramie. Since their punishment was simply being put out of the hills, some of the party were soon on their way back. Since there was no punishment for most Black Hills trespassers, the Army's job of keeping them out was almost impossible. But when miners made it to the hills, they soon found out that there was more to making a fortune in the hills than just getting there. Sure, there was gold in the area, but to many miners, it didn't seem there was very much of it. Small towns like Custer sprang up to serve the miners' needs, but some miners left in disgust, and others began searching gulches and draws during the summer of 1875. The geologist who had been on the Custer expedition now claimed he hadn't even seen any gold in the hills. Some miners coming out of the hills said that the gold supplies were limited. To settle the question once and for all, it was decided to send another expedition to the hills in the summer of 1875. The result of this decision was the Newton-Jenny expedition, led by scientist Walter P. Jenny and Henry Newton. The expedition included some experienced miners and 400 soldiers commanded by Colonel Richard I. Dodge. The expedition left Fort Laramie in May of 1875 and spent over 5 months examining the Black Hills for gold. Finally, the expedition reported that there were limited quantities of gold in the Black Hills, but the land and forest made the hills, as Colonel Dodge put it, in many respects, the finest country I've seen. The expedition found over 1,000 trespassing miners, and another party of soldiers, led by General George Crook, was sent to gather up the trespassers and escort them out. So now, the word coming out of the Black Hills was that there was gold there, but not as much as everyone believed there was. Prospectors were about to prove them wrong. The big Black Hills bonanza in Deadwood Gulch was still waiting for someone to find it. Coming west from Fort Pierre, a seven-man group led by Frank Bryant and James Pearson built a cabin near Whitewood Creek at the mouth of the Spruce Gulch in what is now Lower Deadwood. They prospected for a couple of weeks. And then, on November 8, 1875, Bryant struck it rich in Spruce Gulch. The following day, November 9th, Pearson made a gold strike at the mouth of Blacktail Gulch, and the great Deadwood gold rush was off and running. A single claim like Bryant's 300 feet of stream bottom could produce $140,000 in gold dust in 4 months in the year of 1876. At today's prices, that would be worth even more than $1 million. The first snows of the season had already come when Bryant and Pearson had made their discoveries. They and a handful of other miners worked their claims as weather allowed and mined many of the good gravel bars before the swarm of miners began to reach Deadwood in the spring of 1876. When spring came, all roads would lead to Deadwood.
Well, it didn't take long for very many miners to go bust. By 1876, 2 years after the gold rush was first announced, there weren't too many places left to get gold very easily. All the good claims had been taken. Most of the miners worked creeks with pans like these to get the placer gold. That was gold that had been washed down from quartz deposits and was buried in the sand and gravel beds of streams. What you do is maybe scoop up a handful of gravel from a stream bed and then swish it in the pan to get the bigger rocks towards the front. And then you'd kind of shake them out or pick them out with your hand till you got down to about 2 tablespoons of fine gravel. And hopefully there was a little bit of gold in there. You wash her down. Okay. Then you could start swishing for the gold. You'd work the pan. You always want water in your pan. Work the pan in a circular motion. Just like this. You can see this would take a long time. But then sitting out here on a creek in the Black Hills makes the work kind of go pretty easy. You'd swish and swish, and the gold would eventually all build up in the corner right up here, and you could get the water out to put it into your pouch. You'd touch the gold, and it was yours.
When you find a gravel bar with gold in it, then the real work begins. Miners had invented a number of devices for separating gold from gravel in placer mining. Miners might build a sluice, which was a series of long wooden boxes with wood bars or cleats nailed across the bottom. Water from the stream would be dammed up above the sluice so it would run down through the boxes. Gravel would be dumped into the top of the boxes and the water would carry the mud away. Gold dust, which was heavier, would settle to the bottom of the sluice on the upstream side of the wooden cleats. And every so often, the water would be diverted back into the stream and the miners would gather gold dust from the sluice. In areas where water was scarce, miners would use a cradle or a rocker box. The rocker box was a wooden box mounted on rockers. It was slightly tilted and then opened at its lower end. Gravel would be rocked back and forth with water and mud being sloshed out the open end, and the gold would settle into the cleats. The water could be caught and used again. Rockerville, near Rapid City, got its name from the use of rocker boxes. Some miners made money by organizing ditch companies to bring water to these dry camps. With perhaps 10,000 or more miners working the hills through 1876 and 1877, it wasn't long before the placer mining era was over. Some modern-day miners are still trying their luck at it. Now that gold is worth more, people are staking claims, panning and sluicing in hopes of finding the gold that the early miners may have missed. But the days when someone could get rich quick ended quickly in the Black Hills gold rush. Gold in the streams had to come from the rocks above, and as early as 1876, hard rock or quartz mines were being sunk into the hills. When the hard rock mining stage of the gold rush came, it meant that people without money or skill had very little chance of striking it rich. A miner could find a quartz claim and sell out to a mining company as the Manuel brothers did with the homestake. But to try to develop it without a lot of money and machines was just too much work for most miners.
In simple terms, this was the problem. The best gold was compressed in seams in hard quartzite rock. That rock had to be dug up from the ground, crushed, and then the gold dust separated from the rock dust. It was a very expensive and dangerous process. But today, it's the same process the homestake gold mine uses in lead.
When miners found rock which had gold, it was called a lead, they followed it into the ground by making an open pit or tunnel called a shaft. The rock was blown apart with blasting powder. Then the ore was shoveled by hand into small ore cars pulled by mules, horses, burros, and even men. Next, the ore was smashed into powder by stamping mills. Then the miners would mix mercury or quicksilver, as it was called, with the smashed ore. The gold would combine with the mercury. Then the combined gold and mercury mixture would be heated to separate the two. There were a lot of hard rock mines in the hills. In addition to the home stake, there were other large operations, like the Father de Smet and Standby Mine at Rochford. There have been several hundred hard rock gold mines in the Black Hills at one time or another, and you can still see old mine shafts where men tried to dig their way to riches and fame. But what about the people who came to the Black Hills for the gold rush? Suppose their lives were as exciting as people lead us to believe. Was Deadwood as wild and woolly a town as people make us think it is? Well, that's our next South Dakota adventure.